I want to give you a sense for the scope of the issue and the most, what I regard as the most important issues with respect to global food supply. Now, despite what you might have heard emanating from some quarters in the United States, where, for instance, in the new administration, there are senior administrators and cabinet members who are skeptical about the reality of climate change, the science is extremely strong and very well grounded. Global warming is happening. It's mostly caused by humans. And to be perfectly clear, if it's not slowed, its consequences will be increasingly severe as we go out this century. This is a problem that may not seem particularly acute at the moment, but its impacts will be felt extremely acutely by people in the middle of the century, and especially by the children who are alive today towards the end of the century. Most of you are probably familiar with the basic science. Just to recap, global warming is caused by an imbalance in radiation between radiation that's coming from space into the atmosphere to the surface of the planet, solar radiation, and then re-radiated back out to space as infrared radiation. There's a slight imbalance. It amounts to about 0.9 watts per square meter across the surface of the planet. That doesn't seem very much. It's caused by changes in the transparency of the radiation, transparency of the atmosphere to infrared radiation because of emissions of greenhouse gases, as I'll discuss in a moment. That 0.9 watts per square meter may not seem like very much, but when you add it up across the entire surface of the planet, it's an enormous amount of energy on a daily basis, calculated to be roughly equivalent to exploding 400,000 Hiroshima-type bombs in the atmosphere on a daily basis, day after day after day. So it is really a very large amount of information on aggregate at the planetary level. I'll spend a bit of time talking about emission trends in the past, emission trends in the present, and the consequent global warming in the present and going into the future, past, present, and future. So this is a chart of emission trends, changes in concentrations of key greenhouse gases in the global atmosphere. Three in particular, as you can see, nitrous oxide, methane, and carbon dioxide, all three emitted in very large quantities by the agricultural sector. I put this chart up, it goes back to zero, the current era, to give you a sense for the magnitude of the change in the concentrations of these three gases in the atmosphere and how quickly this has happened since the advent of the first industrial revolution around the middle of the 18th century, and especially very rapid increases in recent decades. The data on this chart are slightly out of date, but if you look at this red line here, that's carbon dioxide. We recently passed 400 parts per million in the atmosphere just this past year of carbon dioxide. And the increases are as high as they ever have been on an annual basis. The food sector contributes a great deal, as you can see from this slide, to greenhouse gas emissions. Overall, food systems contribute between 19 and 29% of global human-emitted greenhouse gas emissions, and the agricultural production, including direct emissions associated with changes in land cover, contributes about 80 to 86% of that total. So on balance, it's around a fifth of human emissions of greenhouse gases originates in the agricultural sector. And there will be some discussion of that issue by subsequent speakers today. Looking at the consequent global warming as a result of these emissions, this chart shows three maps of the planet, one each for the decades 1970s, 1980s, 1990s, and 2000s. Again, impressionistically, you can see that there has been a substantial warming compared to a baseline of temperatures in the middle of the 20th century. You can see that there's a lot of red and a lot of orange in the bottom right-hand map. And that warming is most substantial in the northern hemisphere, especially in the polar regions in the northern hemisphere. And that's significantly because of what's called the ice albedo feedback in the North Pole, loss of sea ice because of warming in the polar regions in the Arctic basin. The result is exposed ocean, which is dark, which absorbs much more solar radiation, and that produces more loss of sea ice. And that positive feedback is accentuating warming in the polar regions. And we're finding that warming there is around twice as fast as elsewhere on the planet. We aren't sure of the total consequences of this change and the energy balance in the northern part of the planet, but we think that it has significant effects on the polar vortex that drives the jet streams around the polar basin. And therefore, probably significant effects on climate and weather patterns further south in temperate regions, which are very important food-producing regions. If we want to look at the aggregate of global warming around the planet, sort of averaging it around the surface of the entire planet, we see this kind of trend line. Across the bottom, we're going back to 1880 up to the present, 2016. And on the left-hand axis, you see temperatures in Celsius. The zero point the chart is normalized to the average temperature on the planet between about 1880 and 1940. You can see there's been very substantial warming since the 1960s. The black squares are the average global temperature at the surface of the planet for each of those years. The blue line is the 12-month running mean or running average. And then the red line is the one that's most smoothed out, is 132-month running mean. That's really what you should pay attention to and try if you want to try to get a sense for the trend line with respect to global warming. We've seen about 1.1 degrees warming since the middle of the 19th century. The variation that you see around the red line is a result of what's called the ENSO phenomenon, the El Nino Southern Oscillation, sloshing of warm water back and forth in the South Pacific. You've heard about this phenomenon when you have the El Nino phase of the ENSO phenomenon. You get more warming on the planet. You get a warming spike. When you have a La Nina phase, you get a cooling on the planet. And it's a chaotic phenomenon that produces variation around the trend line change. We had a very strong El Nino event in this past 3 years, 2 years or so, which has produced the sharp spike in temperatures. The square box for 2016 actually comes out at the top of that blue line on the right-hand side. We've had the three warmest years on record in the last 3 years. It's likely that there'll be some reversion to the mean, but the long-term trend line represented by that red line is entirely in line with scientific models. And it shows no signs of changing. If we want to look towards the future in terms of what kind of warming we're going to see in the future, this is a chart that was produced a number of years ago by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, Working Group 1. It's still entirely valid, though. I find it useful because it gives us a sense for the kind of change we're facing in the context of modern human civilization. This goes back to 500 in the current era. The light blue line across the bottom is an estimate of global temperatures, again, normalized to 0 degrees, using proxy data, such as tree ring data, because of course we didn't have weather stations in those days. The black line shows warming as a function that's been measured by weather stations around the planet. And then the color lines are projections into the future using models, climate models. The most important thing that I want to communicate with this slide is just how different the world is going to be later this century from the world we have experienced during the course of the evolution of modern human civilization. It's going to be radically different from what we've seen before. That variation of the blue line is all within about 0.75 degrees over a period of almost 1,500 years. And this century, we're moving far outside that envelope. Outside the envelope of temperatures during which human beings laid down their industrial infrastructure, their agricultural systems, their irrigation systems, their road networks, their ports, their major cities. And this is going to involve an enormous adaptation challenge for human beings, being in such a radically different climate regime. We're going to get at least 2 degrees warming. I don't think we're going to be any less than that, even under the most optimistic scenarios. And we may well be looking at 3 to 4 degrees warming, so radically different from what we've experienced to date. So what does this mean for agricultural production and global food supply? The implications are enormous, affecting every aspect of global food supply around the planet. There are potential benefits. For instance, some cold regions in the world might benefit because of longer growing seasons. There are implications for fisheries. There are implications for livestock. I'm not going to be speaking so much about those. I've decided to focus, especially in the next few minutes of my talk, on crops, global crop production, which is the source of most of the calories on the planet that human beings consume. And for crop production, perhaps the most significant implication of climate change is that it revs up or energizes the hydrological cycle, the cycle of water between the surface of the planet and the atmosphere. You're all familiar with this water cycle. You have water evaporated from the oceans and from the surface of the planet, transpired through plants such as forests and crops up into the atmosphere, condensing in clouds, and then precipitating out again down onto the planet. And that cycle, as there's more energy packed in the ocean and atmospheric system, becomes more energetic. That means you've got larger quantities of water cycled through that cycle, and it moves at faster rates. And the consequences are very substantial for agriculture. You get larger storms, which can do enormous damage to agricultural systems. I mean, as you can see here, knocks over plants, and that makes harvesting of crops very difficult. You get drought because of higher transpiration rates. You get water sucked out of the soil, and it's sucked out of the landscape with enormous effects on agricultural systems. And of course, you get flooding, very substantial flooding, because you have larger storms and more precipitation. And this flooding could be extremely severe in coastal areas, especially where you get combined with rising sea levels, also a consequence of global warming, and larger storms coming ashore in agricultural regions. So agricultural regions in low-lying areas along the seacoasts are going to be extremely vulnerable. So in the last part of my presentation, I want to spend just a couple of minutes highlighting a few points by referring to some of the scientific literature. Two points in particular, two aspects of these challenges for global food supply. I'm going to look at drought, and I'm going to look at heat shock or heat stress on crops. I'm going to highlight three scientific papers that have appeared in the last decade or so since 2009. This one by Dai in 2012 forecasts the kind of droughts that we're likely to see through this century, and the story is not a happy one. This is the summary map produced in that article. The top map shows changes in soil moisture going out towards the end of this century, with the oranges and reds and purples and whites indicating more serious decreases in soil moisture of 10% or more. You can see a lot of geographical difference in the impacts, and many of the impacts will fall in very important food-growing regions, such as in North America and Europe, Australia, some in East Asia, and of course, very serious impacts on food-vulnerable regions in sub-Saharan Africa. The lower map looks at drought incidence using the Palmer Drought Severity Index. Again, the colors red, purple, and white indicate the most severe drought, extreme drought, on the Palmer Index. Here's a close-up, and this is what we're looking at towards the end of the century. Very substantial changes in conditions for crop production. The second paper by Schenkler and Roberts appeared in 2009, and this focused on the nonlinear impacts of heat stress on crops. And this is an extremely important point, that you get enormous impacts of heat on crops and crop yields, even with relatively short periods of high temperature. Just to give you an indication, these are the results shown in the paper for maize, where when you have temperatures in excess of 27, 28 degrees, you get with 1 or 2 days of temperatures like that at critical periods during the crop cycle, you get a collapse in yields. 1 day of temperature change from 29 degrees to 40 degrees Celsius produces a 7% decline in maize yields. The results are very similar for rice and for wheat and for soy. And this has to be a major focus of our research in response to climate change is trying to make our crops more resilient to episodes of high heat. Finally, in this paper, Battisti and Naylor look at the incidence of high heat going out further in this century. And again, the story is not a happy one. This is using model data. They summarize that in temperate regions, the hottest seasons on record will represent the future norm in many locations. Looking towards 2040 to 2060, the orange represents a 70 to 90% chance that any particular summer in that period of time between 2040 and 2060 will be warmer than the warmest summer on record to date. The red indicates a 90% chance that any particular summer will be warmer than the warmest summer on record to date. Important food growing regions, again, are affected. But you would look at this and you'd say, well, this is within the realm of adaptation. We can manage this. Getting out towards later in the century, though, the story is not so positive. Large swaths of the planet have a 90 to 100% chance of any particular summer being warmer than the warmest summer on record to date. And of course, those summers on record to date are the summers within which we have developed our crops in order to grow with respect to certain, for instance, levels of heat and heat stress. And we're moving into a radically different world now. So the bottom line, and this is my bottom line, again, being very selective, if I want to communicate just one point coming out of this discussion, agricultural adaptation through technological innovation is essential. And we need to begin now. In fact, we're well behind the curve. It can buy us time to reduce emissions, but sufficient innovation requires major international investments in new varieties of crops, hybridized and probably genetically modified crops that can better withstand climate impacts, in particular drought and heat stress. We are not investing anywhere near as much as we should be in developing the new crops we need for the kind of climate regime we're going to see this century. But adaptation and technological innovation is not enough, unfortunately. We have to lower emissions, and we have to get ahead of this problem of climate change. Without lower emissions, widespread failure of global food systems is likely in the second half of this century, even with the smartest adaptation we can muster. And the agricultural sector can play a major role in cutting these emissions.